So last time we have covered the introduction, data model, the flat file system kind of thing, and then what APIs Zookeeper supports that we have covered, and the Zookeeper, what are things it guarantees, like irreversible updates, and then client FIFO order, and then client will maintain a session with the Zookeeper. Then how is that done? Watches, and then what are the applications of the Zookeeper? Like what are things it can support based on Zookeeper? What things we can implement as a client point of view? That will be covered for the group membership and the configuration management. And then this is indigenous. Then logs. Logs also we covered Mutex right last time, but anyway, we'll just go over it one more time, and then we see the client FIFO order, and then the inadvisable updates, how it is done. Okay, let's go to an example. So this is a Zookeeper as a cluster. It has Z1, Z2, and Z3, and internally this is a state of each Zookeeper. Say an example here, we have how many nodes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 nodes. But this Zookeeper is little lag behind the leader. So this is a leader, okay? And these two are the followers, G2 and G3. So G2 is little lag from the leader. So it got only 4 nodes updates, but the fifth node is still did not had it. But G3 is fully updated with the leader, okay? I'm just showing an example. Now let's go to Mutex, how it is done. Say, so Mutex, say we have like three processes. Process, you can say instead of process, you can say client one maybe. Let's say client one. We have three clients, C1, C2, and C3. All three clients, they want to synchronize between them using a lock. Okay, so if one client get the lock, then other two has to wait. They cannot get it actually, because that's a property of Mutex line. So how these three clients will achieve that using a Zookeeper, we'll see that. So in Zookeeper, we have a top level root node for the state I'm talking about. And under that, if they want to synchronize, they can create a sub node, okay, with that name as lock L. Now this path, one second. So now all these three clients will be having this whole path, I mean slash root node slash L. So this path will be shared to the all the three clients. Now they have to create a node under this node. Whoever node will get created, they will get the lock. Then others two will be waiting. Okay, let's see an example how. So here now all the three clients try to create a node under this lock node. Okay, there's an API, right? To create a node, you can use API called create node. So that create node is here. Create. We can specify the path, data, and then the flags. So I mean all three try to create it, but like say one client only able to create it at the beginning. I mean other two clients they did not get able to create, because here we are saying this lock node whoever creates first under this a child. So the child, say P1, you can say P1 is one kind of lock. So this P1 belongs to C2, you can assume. C2 got a chance to create the node. Now C2 got the lock. Now C1, C3, they did not get the lock. They have to wait until C2 has cleared the lock. Okay. And then once C1 is done with his job, then it has to unlock, right? Then what they do is they will delete this node actually. They will delete it. Once they delete it, then both C1, C3, okay. C1, C3, once they did not get the lock, they can set a watch actually on P1. Both will set a watch on P1. Watch on P1, both C1, C2. So this watch is like he is exist. I mean, this node is there trying to check if the P1 is once cleared, please intimate me. Then once this C2 has once done its job, they clear this, then zookeeper will send a notification to C1, C3 saying that node is free. I mean, the lock is now available. You guys can compete. Now what happens again, C1, C3 will both will try at same time. Then there's a problem here. And so even though only one person will get the lock, but all the clients will try to create, will try to acquire the lock. So that is called a hard effect. So to control that, what zookeeper done is, what they have done is, so now we have only three, but if you have 5-6 clients, right, then the hard effect will be more actually, even though one will get it, but everybody try to create a node to get the lock. So what this zookeeper done is, they have done optimization. So you create all the nodes. I mean, they will maintain a queue kind of thing actually. So all the, whoever creates the first, they'll get the lock. And the whoever create the second node, they will get the after the first node is unlocked it. So like that, they will give the lock to them. So that how they achieved is, let me show that. So now say, now C1 says P1, they call it node name when they create a node, right? Then this is a P2 node name, and this is called P3 node name. Instead, I can make a C1, okay, sorry, not P, maybe I can say L, because that's a lock, right? So this is a L1, this is a L2, and this is a L3 when they create a node, G node. So when C1 creates it, say now C2 node got created first, you can say L2 child, and then C3, I mean, all three are trying at once. You can say so one, I mean, at the same time, or maybe after some time, one after the other. I mean, we don't know that when clients will try to acquire the lock. And now L1 node, and then L3, small L. Now in this, right, once, when they say create, now zookeeper will create the node, and then they have to check. And again, after once the node is created, they were not sure who has the lock now. So they have to get the, what are the chails under this node. Now once C1 will try to get the number of chails under this lock. So everybody will see the same view, right? That is called the linearizable heights actually. Linearizable heights. So everybody will see the same state. So now L2, L1, and then L3, same state I will see. So now client one knows that now lock has L2 having the old lock, means C2 has a lock now. Now C1, C2 has to wait until the lock is cleared. So now what they do is they have to set the watch. So C1 will set a watch on C2. He will set a watch on L2. And L3 will set a watch on L1, whatever the previous node it has, right? Once that node is gone, then only he will get the chance. So like that, they will set a lock. Once it, now C1 is done, they will delete this node. Now once this node is gone, now L1 will intimate to, will get intimation saying the client one, saying this log is gone. Now C1 will get the lock. Once C1 also is done,
I am not able to hear. Is it
the same? Yeah, I think it's.
Hey, we missed you. Mm-hmm. Could you repeat that? The last few statements. We lost the connection, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Please. Right.
Yeah. There is some internet issue. Okay.
No worries. Yeah.
Okay. So now, initially, C2 is holding the lock. Now, C1. C1 is in the second place, right? C1 lock, and then C3 lock in the third place. So now when C2 is holding the lock, C1 will set a watch actually on the C2's lock. So once C2 now is actually done with the lock, and then he deleted his node, then at that time the watch is set on C2, right? C2 lock. The zookeeper will give a notification to C1 saying that the lock is clear, so you can take the lock now. Now C1 will hold the lock. Now after C1, after some time, he also unlocked it. Unlock means here they have to delete the Z node. They deleted it. Now C3 is actually set a watch on C1. So once this node is deleted, now C3 will get a intimation saying that, hey, now you may get the lock, please check it. Now they will go and check number of children. If they are the first node, then they will get the lock. Like that, the C3 will get the lock here at this time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let's see how the example, the code, how they have done it.
So this C1, C2, C3 will attack on Z1 node, right? I mean, or on all the three nodes at simultaneously.
Can you repeat that?
I mean, you have three nodes, right? Z1, Z2, Z3. So when this C1, C2, C3 comes, they will come on a single, I mean, either Z1, Z2, Z3 or simultaneously on all of them.
Simultaneously or like one after the other. So whoever wants to create the node, right? So, I mean, you, if they say the client one wants a node, they have to create a node first. If they want a lock. When the client one creates a lock, that will be one child under this lock G node. These are like G nodes only. These are all G nodes. And then the lock will get it. Who are the first in the queue, they will get the lock first. So these are belongs to the clients actually. The clients actually created the nodes. These are like ephemeral nodes actually. These are like ephemeral nodes. So this node belongs to client C2. This node belongs to client 1. And this node belongs to client 3. Say, for suppose, now C3 got crashed. Somehow the application got crashed. So at that time, this node, I mean, there is a session, right, between the client and the zookeeper. I mean, the node is crashed, the client is crashed. We need to clear this, right? Because these are like ephemeral, actually. If you keep this one, then the lock will be with that guy and then nobody will get the lock. Even though client is not available, but they can still hold the lock if you don't clear this ephemeral node.
Uh-huh.
Then the session timeout happens. Once the session timeout happens, because the client got crashed, right? The session timeout happens, then zookeeper itself will clear this node. Now it has only two childs.
But if it was on the transition of the session, of the killing the session, if it was on the transition at that time itself, it got the lock. Will that be a scenario or it's not a scenario to be considered at all?
Can you repeat that once again?
So I'm saying that, you know, as you said, you lose the session. Maybe you lose the connections. Something mm-hmm. bad happens, isn't it? So, but you are actually now in the first in the queue and you are going to get locked.
Okay, you're saying it is already first node in the zookeeper and it is already holding the lock, you're saying, right?
Yeah, it's holding the lock and then it, for some reasons, actually the connection goes away.
Right. So that time what happens is, I mean, that's a valid point. So it is holding the lock, right? So now the session, the client still has to maintain the session with the zookeeper. So when the session timeout happens, now zookeeper will say that that client is gone. Now the lock is like free. Now it will intimate other client, like there is one more client here, say. So that client gnode will get the lock. Now there's one point, we still see the client C3 can still hold the lock, right? But I think this is an implementation specific. The client has to take care. It has to know the session got expired.
Hmm. Okay. So there is some mechanism to get it.
Yeah.
I think this is how the Chubby works, right? Once the time expires, automatically that lock will be free. Like, I mean,
really?
If the process gets killed here.
Mm. I think Chubby, they give the least timeouts, right? Yeah.
The timeout, some second is there. Yeah, the same thing what Santosh was saying, like before releasing the lock, let's say the client failed or something happened, right? So that lock won't be released. So they have a session time. I mean, after that session time, automatically that lock will be free to be dedicated
released.
To
okay.
8 years. Yeah.
Makes sense. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Otherwise, I mean, it will be stuck always.
Right. Yeah, but that there is something in the infrastructure which already takes care of that. That's important. Yeah, no worries. Yeah. Good. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks. See, go ahead.
Yeah. Now let's see the implementation how they have done it. So for the mutex lock, right? I mean, to acquire the lock, we create the node, and then there are two flags. One is ephemeral node. I mean, the node should be ephemeral always because once the node crashes, then it cannot hold the lock. Okay, this is mandatory. And then sequential. The sequential is important because you are creating a node with the name. You can give a unique name, But if you don't want to give a unique name, and then we need to identify the lock name, right? So that time, if you do the sequential, then they say like lock one, the first node comes, they create some node, they create the lock underscore one. The second client, when it's trying to create a node, they'll get a lock underscore two, something like that, to make the sequential names. They use the sequential. And then once node is created.
Basically, this sequential is actually making sure that we will not have multiple nodes created under the common directory, right?
Multiple nodes with same name.
Yeah.
The names will be always unique. And
names will be always unique, part. Yeah. Maintain that they use the same sequential. Right.
I just heard, I mean, when I joined, you guys are speaking about ephemeral nodes, right? I mean, that's what the ephemeral nodes guarantees, right? That once the client loses sessions, then ephemeral nodes, Z nodes, they'll clear the data automatically.
Those nodes are
cleared. The nodes will be selected.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Destroyed. Yeah.
That's why.
Transient. Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead. I mean, that's why we use ephemeral nodes for this kind of. Talking that only once the client loses session, then
everything is over.
Yeah. So now at this time, say like multiple clients are trying to acquire the lock, right? So everybody try to create the lock here, and then they are not sure who is the first person in the queue, right? So for that, everybody has to get the number of children under the lock node. So this lock is a root node, like L, small L, the L is actual root node. So under this root node, they will ask the number of children, and then they will give the number of children. In the children, if your node is the first node, so this N is the first node, lowest, then you got the lock. If you are not the lowest, then that time, which is the node prior to you, you will set a watch on that guy. This is the step that tells. And then you will set a watch on that. And wait for the watch event, then go to step number two again. Once you get an event saying that the watch event, then you start from the step number two. Again, you try to get the children, and again, you will see whether you are the first in the queue. If not, then again, set the whoever is prior to you holding the lock, you'll set on that.
So what is this watch actually? I mean, in what is it
Okay. Event. So this watch, right? As I mentioned here, right? Say now C2 is holding the lock, L2, right? Now C1 is the second person in the queue. So he can set a watch on C2, I mean the lock L2. So that now L1 set a watch on L2 saying that he exists. If he doesn't exist, then the zookeeper will intimate the client one saying that the lock has got cleared. Now you can hold the lock. So that
then
is
what the what is the use of mutex, right? Mutex will be on and off. No, let's say C2 has taken the lock, right? So he will make the value of mutex as one, saying that now the lock is not free. So whenever any client comes, he'll check the mutex value if it is one or zero, right? Depending on that, he will.
No. We are not maintaining any mutex value here. We are just synchronizing the process. One guy can hold a lock for a time, and then he releases the lock. Then we give it to the other person, and then whoever holding the lock. Okay. Lock the subsequent person they want lock, right? They will set a watch on the previous guy. I understood you're talking about the voice point of view, but that voice is one input, right? But this is like a distributed.
The idea is still the same, right? When you say mutex, it's only one at any point in time, only one can hold the lock.
Exactly, yeah.
Only one.
Because
in the slide here. Go ahead.
No, in the slide you have written mutex and then log. So I thought, where is the use of that mutex? Like, we are not talking.
The mutex, the mutual exclusion they're achieving using this zookeeper hierarchy by following these steps.
I think this mutex and also log. The top one. Yeah, mutex is also log. Like, these terms are a little confusing.
Mutex.
All these are logs, yeah. It's a binary lock, actually.
Yeah, 0, 1. Yeah, it can't take more than 2.
And moving on, I have a question there. So
where?
Let's scroll down. So you're talking about the children here, right? So what children we are talking here? Because for ephemeral loads, there cannot be children, right?
Okay, yeah, you are right. But the thing is, we are creating a children under the root node. Say this capital and the small L, right? Under this L, we are creating the children's ephemeral nodes. So
okay,
for
yeah,
this
yeah.
node, we are trying to get the what are the ephemeral nodes are there.
Yeah, I for a moment I thought like for that ephemeral node, you are talking about children.
Yeah, you are right. Ephemeral node cannot have any children.
Children, yeah.
Yeah, because that's a temporary, right? If you get the children,
yeah,
then who will manage that? Yeah.
Yeah, I have a question. Who is responsible to trigger watch, leader or follower? Because our client is connected to could be connected to follower, yeah, not to leader. And who is responsible to trigger watch? Okay, our client issue exists something coexists, yeah, and who will trigger watch?
Yeah, that's a good point. So the watch will be triggered by the local server. I mean, the root internally will send the updates to the all servers. The watch will be set at the local server. Say in this case, right? Say now client is connected over here. Okay, and this is the root. I mean this is a header. Updates will be sent to the local server G2, and G2 will only manage the watch and all, because the client fee forward will maintain at the local servers.
Okay, so if partitions happens, yeah, if for some reason my Z2 node disappears from the cluster, yeah, if it's do not have full information, yeah, watch will not be triggered.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So that time, so all the clients will send a session, sessions, right? They will have a session. So at that time, the leader, okay, you're talking about the network partition, right? Like this happened.
Yeah. Why exists? Yeah. And I am connecting to Z2. Yeah. So I have a session with Z2.
Right. So that time what happens is now this leader node having a, it has to maintain the health check of the G2. They will be having a heartbeat internally. So if he thinks that this guy is not available or the partition happened, then that time what are the nodes were created with respect to G2, I think they will get timed out and they will get cleared, I guess.
See, with Zookeeper, I mean, when you say connections, all this stuff, it's all Z nodes. I mean, the information stored
right
in Z nodes. And everything is replicated. Like everything is replicated. So all the nodes will have that information.
Oh, yes. All nodes will have the information. And then there's one more point is like when the G node is trying to get this happens, right? So what happens is there's a heartbeat for this guy also. G2 is think that now the leader is not available. Now he will try to become a leader. Okay. Then at that time he will stop serving all the client requests. I mean, he will try to become a leader. So the he will try to connect an election. Then until election succeeds, then you will not serve the client request. So in that way, it is safe, right? The state.
Yeah.
Is that clear, Nick?
Yeah, and so if Z2 is not able to serve any request, yeah, my client will reconnect to another cluster node, yeah, and
right.
probably my ephemeral node will be disappears in this case, yeah.
Right. Yes, you are right.
Yes. Thank you. Yeah, it's clear.
Okay, I want to tell you, like this looks, I mean, this tree hierarchy, right? If you see, this looks very simple, right? This is like Unix file system. But the thing is, they have done a lot of synchronization primitives using this just tree hierarchy. There is an Apache curator, one project. So that's like they have built a lot of synchronization primitives. Like, what do you name it, right? All synchronization, like logs, barriers, they created with this tree hierarchy only. Maybe if you guys are interested, then you can refer that project. Okay, this is for lock, how we create the locks. And then the unlock is like, we need to delete the G node. Now let's go to read write locks. So read write locks, okay. So for the mutex, right, only one person can hold the lock. Okay. Whereas for the read write locks, so what happens is for the read, so reads can only wait for the write is happening or not. If there's no write, then all reads can acquire the lock, right? But whereas write has to wait for the previous write and then the read also, right? So I mean this is a property of OS. So multiple read has multiple.
It's like shared lock versus
acquire the lock. Yeah, but when you're trying to do a write, but only no other readers are writes will be allowed. Okay. So for that purpose, this is simple logic. Let me introduce a small example how it is done. I mean, the same tree, instead of drawing this tree, I'll just make a queue. Okay.
I couldn't understand this read write. Can you?
Oh, yeah.
Sure. These are shared and exclusive lock. Same thing as shared and exclusive lock.
Okay. I mean, when the client wants to write something, it has to be exclusive. I mean, it should be like only he can acquire the lock when you try to write something, right? Mm-hmm. And every other writes and reads has to wait until this write is done.
Or until it's not committed, right?
Yeah, until the write is completed. So all readers and writers has to wait.
So if they read in between, some inconsistent information might be.
Yes. Inconsistent okay. Information. And some other client also, they should not write again because one write is already ongoing, right?
True, yeah.
Okay. Whereas for the read, when some client is trying to read, so some other clients also can actually read the system, but not the writes. Okay. Right? Yeah. So multiple reads are allowed. But only one write is allowed. Okay. Okay. Now let's set an example. Say like we got W1, one write, and then W2, and then you got read one, and then W3, and then R2, R3, then W4. So this is the queue. I mean, these are all like maintained in the like Zia hierarchy. You can say like the childs actually. Okay. Now, when the first guy trying to write, right? Now this is a W1. Now he will hold the lock. Whichever clients created this W1, they will hold the lock. And for the W2, he will set a watch on W1. So this is a holding lock holding. Okay. This thing. And here we can say watches. Okay. Now W2 has to wait until W1 is done. And the read one has to wait until W2 is done, right? And then W3 has to wait until read one is done. And R2 has to wait until W3 is done. Similarly, R3 also wait until W3 is done. Okay. Now for the W4, it has to wait until R2 is done. And R2 or R3. I mean, the first node usually they set it. Is it clear? Because here, both R2 and R3 will wait on W3 only. Once W3 is cleared the lock, the client who creates W3, now both R2 and R3 will get the lock, both of these guys.
Okay, so R2 and R3 don't need to wait for each other because both are
really. Yeah, they don't need to wait for each other, yes. Okay, that is the only difference. Okay. For the write lock, whatever the previous lock I mentioned here, right? For the mutual exclusion, that is same. For the read lock, there's a slight change. When the read lock is created, when your node is prior to your node, if any write is there, you will block on that. Okay. If prior to your node, there's no write, then they can hold the lock. Okay. Let's see the example. For the write lock, same thing. Whatever we have done here, the same thing only will come into here because only write will be allowed, right? There's no one else can access the at that time. For the read lock, slight change. Here you create the node and you get the number of children and what are the children's present. If no write G node lower than N in C, then you will get the lock. We don't care if there is some other multiple reads are there, still you will get the lock. Say you are at this point of time, And then these all nodes were cleared already. You can assume these all cleared. When you are here, this R3 will check there's no write in front of me. Then so I got the lock. Even though there's R2 is available, both the things, both these guys will get the lock. That's what I was trying to say here. If there's no write, then you got the lock. If there is a write, then you set a watch on that guy.
So these things will create latency, right? I mean, although consistency will be good because if you are writing, you are not allowing others to write, right? But other process will starve, isn't it, for that much amount of time till the one write is completed.
I mean, that is there in OS also, right? The client will do some other job.
Okay. Mm-hmm. During that period, right? And once the lock is free,
then they can do with respect to that lock, they can do whatever job is associated with that.
Okay.
If we clear, then we can go to next session. I didn't take much examples. I think these are like basic examples. Okay. Let's go to implementation. So for the Zookeeper service, these are the modules. One is a request processor, atomic broadcast, this is JAP, and this is a replicated database. So when the write request comes, it goes to request processor, and then each request, if there's a state updates, right, that is a write, then by using a transaction, they send it to Zookeeper, the broadcast, atomic broadcast, then they will broadcast to all the replicas within the system by using a transaction ID of they made a transaction ID for the each update, and they broadcast to all the nodes. And there is a read request from a client. So that will not go to atomic broadcast. That goes to the local server whom it got connected to, the particular client. And from there, the request will be served. And then, let's go to request processor. Okay, for the write request, it has to go to the leader. And the leader will send it to the atomic broadcast, and they broadcast to all the replicas. Yeah, read request from the local server. And this database, what they maintain, so that is in memory actually. So because of that, the read request will be served very faster, because each Gnode size will be only 1 MB maximum by default. We can configure it if you want more, but they recommend like not to have much data so that we cannot store all database in a RAM. Okay. So you can maintain all the database. This complete tree hierarchy can maintain from the in memory, and the servers, the read request will be faster. So they can scale better. And the client server interaction, Zookeeper follows the FIFO order for the client request. We'll see that in the JAM, how they do it. And they maintain the TCP transport to maintain the messages in order. Notification handled locally. So for the read request, the precedence order is not guaranteed. I mean, you may get some stale entry because if one server is like lagging behind the root, then the read request will not be up to date. But if your application is like so, if they want the precedence order, then you could use a sync call. There's a sync API. With that, you can get the latest updates from the root node, the particular server, and they will serve the most up-to-date values. And then, so the client will actually connect to a server. They maintain a session. The session will be having a timeout, okay? And then the client will be intimated in every message what the server sends, right? Let me put an example. So there's a client C3 here. So he will maintain a session. So that session will be having a timeout. So if there's no activity, so it's a job of client to maintain the session. So if there's no activity, it has to send the heartbeats to maintain the session. And then for every reply got from the Zookeeper to the client, they will include a GXID. So GXID. So the GXID tells that what is the latest update it got, that ID they'll send to the client. So until that point, the client is served, it means. So now the client C3 wants to move to some other G node, because after some time, maybe the client is not able to reach to the server. Then the client can move from here to here. So how it moves is, the client will be having the information of all the G nodes. Okay. I mean, which IP address and which port number they're running. Now clients move from G3 to G2 at that time. So this G2's state is at least as up to date as C3, then only it will move. Say now this GX ID is 10 here, right? Example, I'm saying. C3 got until GX ID 10. But say the G2 GX ID is like until 9 only it is. Now it will not connect. G2 will not connect. Okay. Then whichever has the until 10, the GX ID, at least. So that particular G node, the C3 will move to, and they'll establish a new session with that. But the thing is, if the GX ID is a 10, means definitely it will find a server there it can connect, because when the GX ID 10 means they have the leader got the majority in the cluster, so it can find a G node that has GX ID 10, so it can move there. Now in this case, the 3 node cluster, the G2 is still lagging. Now the client can C3 can go to the G1. It will establish a session over here with this guy, G1. Any questions here?
So, what kind of that DB is that local database in the background? I mean, SQL, NoSQL, or just a normal in the Zookeeper service?
In memory.
That is in memory.
Oh, RAM.
Z nodes are the like local smart stores.
That would be again volatile, right? I mean, it won't be permanent storage kind of.
Yeah, thing. That's why the use cases of Zookeeper are like limited to. You have the limitation on the data size too, right? Like 1 MB. So that's why you store for configuration, service discovery, and all these use cases, like where you store the meta information, not like database.
Yeah, it's not persistent. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then they maintain in memory, and then there's a file system backup also, because if there's a crash, right, they have to recover actually. So they maintain this tree hierarchy in a file system.
Yeah,
but I don't think they use any database. Like.
Yeah. It just is stored in that, but the real thing happens in the memory. That is the reason it's very fast also.
Yeah, it's very fast.
Yes, I remember Zookeeper has a walk, and sometimes it do a snapshot of this in memory database.
Oh, sometimes it does that. Okay. Huh.
Yeah.
Probably
recommend it.
Snapshot.
Yeah. Very good.
Yeah, very good. Yeah.
Yeah, this is Zookeeper. And then the reference, I took the Zookeeper white paper. So that only I have referred everything, but there could be some new updates now, but that I have not gone through it. But yeah, these are the basics. Yeah.
So you are saying now, the reference you took of all the Zookeeper from this reference? Wait.
Yeah. Right.
White paper.
Yeah. Okay. If there's no questions, then we can go to Jab.
Okay.
So this TCP connection is between the client and that ephemeral node that you mentioned, right? Client-server interaction uses TCP for transport to maintain the message ordering network. Message ordering, mm-hmm. I mean, what is that?
The message order, I mean, they say like FIFO order, right? So they use that TCP so that they can maintain the ordering. And they use the TCP between the Zookeeper. Servers also.
So how TCP will help? There should be some numbers associated with two in order to.
I mean, they maintain the numbering also, but they say like with respect to TCP, the order will be maintained. They say.
TCP, I mean, the order, like what are you saying? The whole thing is divided into multiple packets, right? So there you can like say the packet like is in the proper order.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay, sequential.
But but nothing more than that. Okay. Like when you send multiple messages, then that is where like Zookeeper order, FIFO order comes into play. That's it. But this TCP order is differently different.
Okay.
So the thing is, say two packets you're trying to send in a TCP, right? So two packets, they're already in the transit. So they will be guaranteed using the TCP. Say now one packet out of that ordering, if it tried max retries and failed. So at that time, the zookeeper application has to take care of maintaining the order.
And application.
Yeah, right. Let's go to JAP. JAB is a crash recovery atomic broadcast. It is mainly designed for the zookeeper, and it does atomic updates. And its main responsibilities is like agreeing on a leader in ensemble, and it synchronizes all the servers. It broadcasts updates. And it's recovering from the crash state to a valid state. Yeah, this all makes sense, right? Now,
so this atomic broadcast was to coordinate all the zookeeper services, right? I mean, in the diagram, it was. We had write request used to come, and then it used to go to the atomic broadcast. From there, it used to go to the replica, DB replica, right?
Right.
Right. What is the use of this atomic broadcast? Like whatever write it gets, that gets delegated to all the DBs.
All the nodes in an order of
order of coming.
I mean they have like there's no transaction ID, so with just with the transaction ID they maintain the order. Yeah, I mean we'll just go through examples how it is done.
Okay.
So I mean the JAB is implemented on based on the Paxos. So we need to have a little understanding on Paxos to understand the JAB, because they have modified the Paxos to fit this. And then they say Paxos is like a traditional protocol. So that is not intended for the FIFO ordering and atomic broadcasting. Because we have seen last time the Paxos, right? They're like multiple servers can actually propose the values, and with respect to that, the ordering will not be guaranteed. So whereas in JAB, there's only one leader, and with respect to the transaction ID, they're maintaining the total order. So the thing is,
it's a consensus protocol, right? It's for leader election.
I mean, this is also consensus only JAB.
Yeah,
but with respect to consensus, they maintain the order also.
Yeah, that's an additional gather.
Yeah, that additional order in the Paxos.
Yeah, can I ask here why we are talking that it based on Paxos but not in a Raft? Yeah, in Raft we also have one leader, and the leader is responsible for order. It looks like more similar to Raft or multi. Paxos. Why Paxos?
Actually, right, it is similar to Paxos. And then some of the similarities, right? You're actually right. Some similarities, it looks similar to Raft also. Yeah, we'll show the examples. But the why I said like it is implemented based on Paxos, right? I mean, Paxos also like one leader is there. If you talk about multi-Paxos, they maintain one leader. But still, they say if there is more than one leader also, there's no harm in Paxos. But in JAB, we should have strictly one leader, whereas in the Raft also.
Why not Raft, why Paxos? Is that what you asked, Nick?
Yeah, well, it's quite more Raft than Paxos, yeah?
Maybe we need to check when is zookeeper really, when is this JAB protocol is implemented. One very high level question, or maybe very simple question. See, a zookeeper is a coordinating service, isn't it? Right?
Yes.
So yeah. JAB is actually going to be, you know, whatever that automatic broadcast. And it is designed for zookeeper coordination service. Now, JAB becomes a coordination service for zookeeper. Is that what it means? The very first statement.
Yes.
Then who is going to be a coordinating service for Zap then? Well, is it a recursive keeps going that? Because I understand, you know, even if it's a coordination service, Zookeeper, we see that it's very, very reliable. And that is what all the other distributed components depend on it for getting the configuration information. Now we understand we are going in Zookeeper. We look at that. So we have a Zap, which is actually coordinating service for Zookeeper. Because we also find that there are some issues, maybe in very worst cases, Zookeeper can go wrong. So we have to have a coordinating service for that. Now we have Zap, fine. But other than, is there some other component in Zap which has to have any coordination service? I know it is not a, maybe it's not a...
It is a protocol, right? Like it is like Paxos for, you know, leader election and stuff. But Zookeeper uses that to do whatever it does.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, I'm not understanding it. That is the reason I'm asking a very stupid question.
So the Jab, right? Jab will not maintain any state. So it is trying to help the Zookeeper to maintain the ordering of messages what the Zookeeper leader is trying to send. So despite that, the Jab is making sure the order is guaranteed. And then for the Zookeeper leader election, so that null will be taken care of the Jab. So how they do it, I mean, that we'll see.
Okay.
I think Paxos is the underlying algorithm under Jab, right? So functions Jab might be doing by the Paxos only.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, the Jab is implemented on top of Paxos, but as Nick has pointed, the similarities look actually. I feel like it is a hybrid version of Paxos and then the Raft. If you see the complete understanding it after the end of the slide, you will feel like it's a hybrid version of both. But thing is, it's actually based on the Paxos, implemented based on Paxos on top of it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Paxos has so many versions too, so this keeps on. It's like another version.
Yeah. I mean, we'll see the examples like how it is done, and then maybe at the end of it, yeah, we'll understand. So sometime while Jab, we'll see how Paxos it was done and how Raft it was done. So we'll get some idea on all three. Okay. So the Jab uses a transaction identifier for the total order because now we'll see what is GX ID. So for each transaction, say the VZ, right? So VZ is the value and G is the transaction ID. So the G containing E and C. So E is the epoch number for the primary. So because we have like multiple servers, right? There's a primary and others are follower. So one node becomes primary. So it has to change the epoch number. So we have seen in the Paxos and the Raft, right? There is election term. So that is term actually here, the epoch. Because they have to for each term only one leader is the will only serve the new updates for that purpose. They use epoch, and then C is integer. So this is a unique point actually. If you compare Raft and Paxos, for every message we maintain an ordering using this C. I mean, once one guy is a leader, then the counter becoming zero. When he's trying to update the update every update, they increment this number. Whereas in Paxos and Raft, they don't have this this C number one counter because all the messages having the same term ID. So I don't say there will be order mismatch, but thing is, it can happen. Okay, but here they're maintaining every message, every update with a transaction with a counter. So that way the order, every message have an order. Okay, we'll see the phases, how it is done. There are three phases mainly. One is discovery phase, synchronization, and then the broadcast. So prior to this, there is one more stage called leader election. Okay. So after the leader got elected, then the leader has to synchronize with the, I mean, there is a discovery, synchronization, and broadcast, the three phases. We'll see how it is done. Let's say leader is the middle line is a leader and the above and bottom is a follower. Say if you have a cluster of three nodes, then the majority is two, right? So that's why they made it very nicely. There are two followers bottom and above, leader is middle. Say now, once a leader is trying to get the votes from your two followers, then they will send the what they have epoch, current whatever epoch they have, right? So this is the epoch number E. Because now he become the leader, earlier someone else become the leader, right? So this leader has to know what is the current epoch number everybody has. So he will get from all the followers, C epoch. So once he get the epoch number, now leader has to give the unique epoch, right? So he will take an epoch which is greater than whatever epoch exists in the state, in the zookeeper cluster. So this epoch is 1 and this epoch is 2, right? Say now this leader will take epoch 3, which is greater than whatever exists in the as a whole. That epoch number, new epoch they call, that epoch they broadcast to the all followers. Now this epoch should be new actually. If these followers they don't accept the new epoch, because they don't accept, suppose this epoch is not new, it is a old epoch, and that time they don't accept it. They accept, then they send an ACK. Now from this discovery, we get to know that what is the existing epoch, and we pick a new epoch which is greater than the existing one, that we call it here epoch. And then the next is synchronization. Synchronization is now whichever leader got elected. Okay, here there's one more thing. Okay, maybe that I can cover later. Okay. Once we get the new leader will actually broadcast his logs, its log history to the all the followers. Okay, now they will accept based on the epoch. Once they accept it, and then they the leader will actually commit the log history. Because it is trying to send the log history, the majority of the cluster has to accept the log history. Once they send accept, then we commit that log history. Then the leader is actually synchronized all the followers with the log history. And then now at this point after synchronization, this leader is the actual leader. So until that, the leader is there, they call it as a, this is not a full-fledged leader, they call it as a prospective header until at this point. So now at this point of synchronization is done, then that leader is actually the lead header. Then if any new updates comes, then there's a broadcast happens. If any update comes that they propose the updates, if majority of the cluster is accepted, then only we commit the updates to all the followers who are accepted. Okay, any questions here? If not, then we'll go to in detail how it is done.
So, did you have another question? Because discovery, synchronization, broadcast.
So,
yeah, you can think of discovery as the Paxos. It's nothing but Paxos, right?
Paxos also does the same
thing. And synchronization broadcast is literally like two-phase commit.
The two-phase commit is within that. Everybody has two-phase commit. Because first we
exactly, that's information broadcast.
First we need to tell them that what are the values we have it. That is a phase one. Once they accept it, then we do the commit, right? Then this commit is the phase two.
Yeah. Yeah, that's why I'm saying like you can think of synchronization broadcast as it's a two-phase commit and discovery as a Paxos.
Yeah, two-phase commit used everywhere here. Here also two-phase commit. Here also two-phase commit.
Two-phase commit.
Okay, if you compare, right? Okay, let me compare that way. Like for the raft, what they do is, maybe once we've done that, then we can see the differences. Okay. Let's go to leader election, the phase one. So they call the three phases, but actually there are four phases, because in this diagram, the leader election, they didn't include it. After leader election, there's a discovery, they call it. So actually four phases, but they call it like three and four sometimes. Yeah. So for the leader election, so every leader has a heartbeat mechanism. once the timeout happens, then the leader will actually go to the election state, because say first of all, leader is having connecting with the two followers, then leader is not getting any acts or any heartbeat messages for a period of time. Then heartbeat expires. Then that time, the leader will go into follower state and go to the election state. I mean, the leader will not become leader at that time. It will start the election. And then every peer that starts, they say they go into election state. And the follower moves to election state if leader has failed. Yeah, that makes sense. This is the point I'm trying to say. When the leader announces the leadership and moves to election state, if it does not receive heartbeats from a quorum of followers. So these are the states where these are the scenarios when a peer can start an election. Okay. Once election started, there is a prospective leader will come into picture. Say now when P dash voted for a P, now P is becoming a prospective leader of P dash. Okay. Now peer is say for example when you are trying to get a vote, when you are trying to conduct election, then you vote for yourself, right? That is self-voting. That is called that peer is will be in the leading state, and others otherwise it's actually follower state. Now in this case, now the leader, right? Now leader has to vote itself first, then that leader will be in the leading state. Whereas these two followers has voted for the leader, then that time for these two followers, this guy is the prospective leader. I think this diagram makes it clear, right?
Yeah, can I ask here? In Raft, yeah, they use something like random delay, random sleep. Yeah, there is nothing similar here. Yeah,
random sleep. Otherwise, everything will be like at the same time sending the heartbeats.
Yeah, but I think they didn't mention it here. But I think they have to do that here as well, because if everybody not starting it randomly, then the thing is leader election will take a lot of time, right? Because everybody will try to become try to collect election, then the election time will take time. But they didn't mention that part, but I feel they have to do that.
Yeah, but if we use some random delay, it means that our algorithm is not deterministic. Yeah, it depends on the random value. Maybe they want to have more deterministic way. Does it make sense? I don't know.
Because here we're trying to get election, right? So we need to get the majority of the votes. To get the majority, if everybody trying to becoming a leader, then the majority will not happen, right?
It will take some time.
So to save the time, if you start a random time, I mean, the paper, they didn't mention about that. I mean, whatever I'm explaining, it could be old also, but maybe the newer implementations, they might have a random time or, I mean, to start election very quickly.
Yeah, because we also...
That is the same problem being addressed in Raft 2, right?
Yeah, Raft also it has the same problem. And the same thing is there in the Paxos as well. Right?
In Paxos we also have a random delay?
Random? What is that you said?
Do you mean that in Paxos we also have a random delay, random sleep? Yeah.
Okay. Paxos, okay. I'll tell you. The Paxos, right? They didn't say leader election. They didn't include in the paper. They say like leader election is out of Paxos. They told. There's a separate algorithm. They support the consensus, whichever algorithm they use it. But as well as a Raft, as a tightly coupled with the electing elite. Leader. So without leader, they cannot. Without only one leader, the Raft cluster will not be up. So for that purpose, they given the electing of a leader very efficiently in that. Because Paxos, they didn't mention that clearly.
Okay.
And then one more thing for the Raft, right? They told it's a simple algorithm. So I feel the simple algorithm, because they explain everything in the paper, each and every detail, how the election is done, what are the scenarios they are doing election, And whereas Paxos, they made generic election. We don't care. We don't follow only one algorithm to do the election. You bring up with your own election. The Paxos will support the consensus on that whatever the algorithm trying to bring it up to elect a new leader.
Paxos doesn't directly talk about it, but it does like. I mean, it is also a consensus algorithm, right? Like, when we talk about consensus, we are talking about the leader itself, right?
Yes.
Not I mean, leader, but taking over a value. Yeah, maybe in that sense.
Yeah, I mean, they support whichever algorithm you bring in as a leader election. They all the followers and all the nodes in the Paxos cluster, they support the consensus to elect a leader.
Yeah, consensus, agreeing to one value.
That's
that sense, yeah.
The guarantee. That's what they get.
In Raft, it is pretty clear. Like we talk about leader.
Raft is pretty clear. We need to have we need to elect the leader, and whatever algorithm they told, that only everybody has to follow in Raft.
And by the way, the diagram, you know, the discovery diagram and the water you put in under the redirection, like the discovery sounds like Paxos, but the leader election, the points is totally Raft, like for the first three.
No. This is not a leader election. I'm talking about
it looks that way, you know.
I mean, these are like three states. This is phase one, phase two, phase three, but this phase zero is there. This is the leader election. Okay. Yeah, we can go to the phase one, that is a discovery. So here, what I mentioned is we need to find out what is the epoch time already existing in the cluster. And then after understanding what is the currently used epoch, then only we need to pick up the new epoch, right? That one. And the second one is the leader will actually get the log history from all the followers. So that they didn't mention here in the diagram, but actually it does two things. One is to get the epoch, what is currently used, and then the log history from the followers. Okay. And then once you get the log history, out of the log history, which is the latest log history, that leader will take it and that they will update to the all followers. Got it? Okay, there are two. Gather the most recent transactions from all the followers, which is accepted it, and then establish a new epoch. The two things it does actually mean in this state, that discovery state. Okay, there is one how the message flow, right? Let me, if you guys are interested, then I can show you this. I don't know whether you have time permits or not. Okay, the followers will send the. Okay. Are you guys able to see this?
You can increase a little bit font.
Okay, let me, I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So now initially follower will send the follower info. Okay, send the follower info that what is the accepted epoch to L, and then it comes to the leader. Now leader will actually try to get the max epoch out of all the accepted epochs. Then it gets then it will make a new epoch which is greater than the currently existing epoch. Then that one it will send it to the new epoch to the all followers. That's what we see in the diagram. Once the new epoch goes to the followers, so here in these. Whatever previously they sent accept epoch, right? That should be greater than the whatever new epoch actually sent it should be greater than that. Then only they accept it. Or else this follower will go into the election state if they send some older epoch number. Okay. So in this, they update the accept epoch because why they update accept epoch is like when the news, when some other new node becoming a new leader, then that time they will not allow them. So this is helpful. Say suppose old leader, right? It just died and then just came back, and then it sees it's epoch, right? And then he thinks that he's still the leader. Then that time it's trying to send any messages. Then that time these followers will actually block it because hey, we have a newly accepted epoch. Your epoch is still older. And then you try to become a follower. For that purpose, they use this accept epoch. And then now these guys will send the what is the current epoch and history. This log history is important. And then the last GX ID, these two things they will send it to the leader. from this they get the latest GX ID and the history. Okay, so that one they send it to the, I mean they store it. Okay, that they store it. Let's go back to here once. So we send the new epoch, right? In the ACK case, we get the a log history here, the log history. The log history will get it. And then here, the log history will be sent to the, all the followers. Okay, let's see that one here.
Sorry, does it mean that whole log file will be sent? Or just update? Or maybe it's not about a log file at all. What is the log history? Is it part of log file? Or...
Could you repeat that question once again?
What is a history? What does it mean to send the history?
Oh, okay. The history is a log history. I mean, till now, whatever the state they have updated, right? The state.
Transaction history, yeah.
The edit log, you can say.
Okay, does it mean that follower will send whole his log to a leader?
Yes.
Oh.
All the but followers will send. Okay, all the followers will send the log, the edit log to the leader. Now leader will pick the latest out of it, because the leader could be sometime, it could be lagging, right? Say now whatever the leader now becoming the leader, that guy couldn't have actually caught up with the new the old guy, the old whatever leader is there. So his log history could be older than some of the followers, right? So it has to take the most latest log history.
Okay.
From all the followers.
Okay. It means that leader is not a process with the most recent history. It's just one of node, yeah? And followers have to send his history to leader so that leader update his own history, yeah?
Right. So this is same as like Paxos. So Paxos also does the same thing. Anybody can be leader. And then he can get all the edit log from the followers. But with Raft, what we've done is Raft is like the follower which is lagging behind. They are not eligible to becoming a leader. So the Raft, they have taken care of it. Whichever has the most updated log history, they only can participate in the leader election. So
good to know. By the way, one small question. Does it mean that this discovery further happens for each new message in cluster? Yeah, if client sent a message, discovery further for this discovery will happen. Is it correct or wrong?
No, it's only one time. Only the leader is going to get the synchronization state only in the first time, only after leader winning the election. It's only one time, right? After that, everybody have updated info. Because you want to make sure that leader has the most updated info.
Yeah, this is a little confusing. When you say like this is not leader election, but yet we talk about leader itself. No, you're sending this like a factor test, right? Like passing the latest value. I mean, all the nodes talk to each other and send their value, and then they'll decide like the latest value. And then this is what the Paxos is, right?
Right, Paxos also does the same way.
Yeah,
this is similar to Paxos.
Yeah, that's why when I see the discovery, I feel like this is like a leader election. But then you also mentioned there is like phase zero where you talked about
a
proper leader. Like
one sec. I mean, this is not a leader election. Leader election is done here prior to this step. The discovery prior to that, the leader election is done. But thing is, that guy is not the leader until he will get the latest updates from all the followers. So they call it like prospective leader at this point of time. If you draw one more line over here, at this time the leader is not finalized.
If the leader is not, if you say like, wait, you say leader is not finalized, but here we talked about like leader is passing the information here. That's what I'm saying. Like in the discovery, but still the leader is not finalized, right?
I mean, in this process, right, I'll tell you here. So there are some failure cases here. If you see that in this state, that the discovery state, say he sent an epoch, right? That epoch went to the follower. So the epoch is not up to date value. Then it can, then this follower will try to connect a new election.
Exactly. I mean, every follower should like accept the value. Then acknowledge that value, then only then like the initiator will become the leader, right?
Yeah. So what I mean to say is, in this state that discovery state, now whatever leader till now we are assuming, that will not be a final leader. In between, in this cases, there are failure states, right? In that state, the other followers also will connect an election. They becoming the leader, and that time this leader, what are they trying to say? This will become a follower again. So because that they say
maybe
it is not a finalized state.
Okay, maybe let me put it this way. On the discovery, like the discovery, what do you say, diagram. So rather than putting follower leader, you could tell it's like a proposer and the followers, right?
Yeah. So yeah. Only the leader is a proposed leader for the discovery entry, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, but see,
only the
good.
Only after the discovery, then we get to know like that the proposer is actually the leader.
Mm-hmm.
Like no, once it enters the synchronization.
On a high level, but he's saying that there is another corner case wherein that cannot happen, isn't it?
Yeah.
Sri. But so in that case, if that is a that is what is rejected, the proposed leader is rejected. So what does that happen? Again, it goes for the leader election like phase zero.
Yes. Yes.
Mm.
Again, this continuously happens, right? Even in the Paxos, it's quite the same, right? Like,
But I mean, is it not? See, in some cases, it might go for a long, and then you'll have more of an unavailability, some sort of thing.
Okay. That will not happen here.
Okay.
I'll tell you because why? Because they're trying to cover all the cases, right? Say this leader is trying to say now, this is a new leader trying to become a leader. Now the same scenario happened for the old leader also. Now old leader also has the same flow, like what we are showing here. So that guy thinks that he's still the leader when he is trying to propose these values, and then at that time we block it actually based on these entries. If his epoch is greater than how to tell that? Okay.
Yeah, because the epoch time will be greater for the new proposed leader, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
Correct.
It's like an election term. Yeah. Like
keeps on implementing. Yeah. Right. Okay. Yeah. So the older one is eliminated. So, correct.
Older one will be eliminated. Say now this case applicable for the older guy also. So that guy will be eliminated. And which are the new leader trying to becoming win the election? They will win actually here by using this diagram and this flow.
Okay. So, but then are you trying to say that the proposed leader will almost always be a leader?
Yes. The proposed leader, the chance of winning will be more.
Yeah, chance of winning. So it will be 99%, but still 1% remains, isn't it?
Right. Still 1%. Because, say now here, let me go to here. So this follower initially gave his epoch to this leader, right? Now he calculated a new epoch and he's trying to broadcast. Now in between, the another leader came, that guy gave higher value of the epoch to this follower. Now, while sending this new epoch, he may not accept it now.
Exactly. I'm very confused on this. Like the discovery phase, like it's a phase one phase you mentioned, right? Like phase one.
Mm-hmm. Phase one.
And phase zero, you say there is a leader election. Like by the end of phase zero, you see. Like there is a leader, right?
Mm-hmm.
But so he's saying, phase, Sri is saying, whenever you enter a discovery phase, you assume that it's only a prospective leader. He is not a leader at all. So after the end of the discovery phase, only he is a leader.
No, not end of the synchronization phase.
Okay, yeah. But at least when you're moving from the discovery, your prospective leader has more chance of becoming a leader, isn't it?
Right, you are right.
Okay.
It's like a RAF plus Paxos combined to get
yeah.
It's interesting, yeah.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
Okay. I think let's wind up today because I have
yeah, please. Yeah, right yeah, now. You are right. Yeah. Right. No, he did a very great job actually. Sri getting all these details.
Yeah, yeah,
really difficult. Yeah.
Yeah, he went into like pretty detailed.
I mean, you, because initially I think maybe we can stop the recording maybe.
Okay. Yeah. Let me stop.
Yeah, we can just talk off.